Hi, in this tips and tricks video, I'm going to discuss how to use planar symmetry in your finite element models. So, oftentimes it comes up in our work that, we're building a model and we're working with, high number of degrees of freedoms, a large number of nodes, and we're working with limited computer resources. In those cases, it may be worth your time to see if you can employ symmetry in your model. So basically, looking for ways where your model is symmetric in terms of geometry, materials, loading, to reduce the number of degrees of freedom. So I'm going to go over some of the basics behind planar symmetry. Now there's a lot of types of symmetry, so cyclic symmetry, axis symmetry, general axis symmetry, all of which are good to know how to do, but this is just sort of covering basic planar symmetry. So I've got this test model set up. It's just a simple tensile test specimen with a load of 100 newtons along the axis and a fixed support on the other end. So this isn't a particularly large model, but if you can imagine, if you were to consider a much larger problem, then symmetry becomes a little more useful or critical. In this particular instance, we probably wouldn't save a whole lot of time as far as solve time goes. But let's just go through it. So what questions do we need to ask in order to figure out if the symmetry assumption is valid? We need to answer the first question, which is the geometry symmetric, right? And about what planes? So for this model, we've got three symmetry planes as far as geometry goes. We've got the YZ plane, right? So that's this plane, okay, cutting along its axis. We've got the XZ plane, so that's this plane, okay? So immediately that tells us we can do up to a quarter model, right? So reducing our number of nodes by a factor of four approximately. We also have a geometric symmetry plane down the center line of, the midpoint of our specimen here. So that's in the XY plane. However, you'll see later that it's not, technically it's not symmetric. It is in terms of geometry, but not for the other two things we're going to talk about. So the second thing is materials. Are the materials symmetric about these planes? We have only one material. So yes, it is symmetric with regard to material. If we had an assembly with multiple parts and multiple materials, that may not be the case. However, it's up to you as the engineer to decide whether or not the differences in materials invalidates the symmetry assumption. It may not. You may still get good answers. And the last question is the loading symmetric, right? So in our case, we have this axial load, so we know that it's symmetric about the XZ plane and the YZ plane, right? But this last geometric symmetry plane, so the XY down the middle like this, technically isn't, right? Because if you just think in terms of if we were to mirror this load about that plane, okay, we would get an axial load of 100 newtons. Okay, that would technically balance, right? That would make sense. We would get tensile behavior, but since we have this fixed support here, the nodes on this face are constrained in the z direction, the axial direction, but they're free to, they're not free to slide along the yx plane, right? So what we get is this Poisson's contraction here. Okay, so you can see the deformed shape from the results is different than it is over here. So you probably could get away with using a symmetry plane here and just considering failure at this point. However, technically it's not symmetric with regards to loads. So, but we're just going to consider symmetry about the YZ and the XZ planes just for the sake of this example. Just looking at the results, we've got a max stress at the root of this fillet of about 3.84 megapascals. Keep that number in your head. I'm going to show a couple of different ways to model in symmetry for this part. We're going to compare our answers. So the first way you can do this is to use a symmetry region. So ANSYS provides a symmetry group that you can insert. You can do that by right-clicking on model and then inserting it, or going to clicking on model there and then inserting a symmetry region, sorry, a symmetry group in the context-sensitive model tab there. It's grayed out because we already have a symmetry object in our tree here. And then once you've done that, you just right-click on it, insert symmetry region. And that's just a simple planar symmetry region. So once we've done that, you can see that we have this core model, like I mentioned earlier. We just assign our symmetry regions. So our first symmetry region is going to be on the ZX face here. So we would just scope that to that face and then set our symmetry normal. In this case, it's going to be the Y axis. So the normal of this face is in the Y direction. So this finite element model will be, you know, mirrored about that plane. And then our second symmetry region will be on this face with the symmetry normal as the X axis. Okay, so if we take a look at our results, we can see that, you know, the deformed shape looks as it should, looks about right, and we're getting a max stress of 3.88 megapascals instead of 3.84, so very close results. So in this case, our symmetry assumption, it works, it's valid. So, you know, this is probably the simplest way of putting in symmetry in your model, is just insert a symmetry region. But I think it helps to, you know, look at other ways of employing symmetry, just to understand sort of what's going on in the background. And so what we need to consider is, you know, what type of constraints are being imposed on these symmetry planes, right? Because that's all it is. There's no nodes or anything on the other side of these symmetry planes that are being accounted for. It's just a displacement condition. So since we have 3D elements, right, each one of these nodes has 3 degrees of freedom. So X translation, Y translation, and Z translation. Those are the only constraints that we can apply here. Of course, we can use remote displacements to constrain rotations, but we don't need to do that. So I'm going to open up another model here, and instead of inserting a symmetry plane, all I've done is inserted 2 displacement conditions in place of the symmetry plane. For the first one, on the YZ symmetry plane, I've imposed a displacement constraint such that the X component of displacement is 0. It's fixed. So the nodes on that plane cannot move in the X direction. And then, of course, the Y and Z components are free. So these nodes are free to move in the Y and Z directions. And then on the other symmetry plane, similarly, we have a displacement condition with the Y component of displacement fixed at 0. And so what this will do is it'll do the exact same thing as this model with the symmetry regions applied. So this is all ANSYS is doing in the background when you apply a symmetry region, is it's just assigning the appropriate displacement conditions. Okay, so if we take a look at the results for this, we get the exact same result as we do with the symmetry condition. We get 3.8801 megapascals as our max. Take a look at our last one, 3.8801 peak. So it's the exact same thing. Now, you know, I've just used displacement conditions here. What about rotations? So these are, you know, 3D elements. They only have 3 degrees of freedom. They don't have rotations. But if we were doing, if we had symmetry regions with shell elements, for instance, those have 6 degrees of freedom. So translation X, Y, and Z, but also rotations X, Y, and Z. In those cases, we would have to actually apply rotational constraints as well. Just keep that in mind. What's another thing we could do to enforce symmetry here? We could also use, we go to our analysis system, we could insert a frictionless support. So for planar symmetry, a frictionless support will do the exact same thing as a symmetry region, as well as a displacement condition that I've applied here. We'll get the exact same answer. Now that being said, now that we've got an idea of what the symmetry region in mechanical is doing in the background, I want to discuss a little bit about why you might want to use a symmetry region in the first place. Well, one, it's maybe a little bit easier to set up. It'll save you just a little bit of time, but I'd say that time savings is probably marginal. But one of the things that allows you to do that's really neat is, if you wanted to, instead of showing this core model in a report, to whoever is reviewing the report, that person might not be, a technical person, or they might not be a finite element person. You want to show them the full sort of 360 degrees of this part, for showing the stress plots. You can do that, and the way we do that is using graphical expansion. So if you have symmetry regions applied here, you can click on the symmetry parent group, and then in the details, you'll notice we get these three beta features that are available if you have beta features enabled. We get three graphical expansions, so it allows you to graphically visualize your result plots for the full model versus just the portion of the model that you've actually included in your finite element model. So these won't actually be used in the computations. It's just for visual purposes. And so the way we do this is for each symmetry plane, you would set up fill out one of these groups. So for the first one, we will do the YZ symmetry plane. So in this case, we need to set our number of repeats to 2. Okay, so what that's going to do is it's going to mirror this mesh about this plane, right? We're only going to repeat it. It's going to be have 2 repeats. And then method is going to be half, so that's right. And then these delta values, what we need to do is enter in a very small value here, and you'll see why in a second. So we've gotten that. That's for the YZ plane. Now we're going to do another one for the XZ plane. So we'll do another one under this graphical expansion 2, our second symmetry region, and again apply a very small delta X. Oops, sorry, actually this should not be delta X. It should be delta Y. So this has to match the normal of your symmetry plane. Okay. Now that we've done that, we can go into our solution branch and take a look at stress. And you can see that it has expanded the results twice. So once about the YZ plane and once about the XZ plane to give us a full view. Now, so what if I had put in a larger value for that delta X and delta Y? Let's say 0.2 for each. What you'll find is there'll be a gap in between the repeats here. And so that's why it's recommended that you use a small value so that these gaps don't show up. But if you did want a gap, it's there. So that's one benefit of using the symmetry regions that are available in mechanical versus manually setting up constraints. So yeah, that's pretty much it as far as planar symmetry goes. So this has been a quick tips and tricks video, and I hope you learned something.